Welcome to BiteSized Therapy Podcast with Dr. Brian Razzino. Dr. Brian Razzino has over 20 years of experience as a talk therapist, and he uses short videos dealing with mental health issues in order to connect and educate hundreds of thousands of people. On this show, Dr. Razzino will make reference to his short clip videos and do his best to explain the mental issue referenced and how it can be addressed. Dr. Razzino does not give medical advice, but hopes that he can help people understand what is going on mentally in order to go ask for clarification with their own personal mental health professional. So, Doc Raz, what do we got going on here? We're starting this off with Netflix.
Starting you off with a promo for Netflix and Jonah Hill's new movie, Stutz. Not really. I encountered this movie the other night, and it's one of those things where, I tell you what, man, it happens to me all the time. I resist and avoid a movie that I see that looks like it could be interesting.
Yeah.
Because I don't know if I want to waste my time or spend my time on this. And then I finally watch it, and I'm just like, damn, that was really good. And this is one of those movies. But it's in the... This is in the spirit of watch two movies and call me in the morning. I mean, basically, movies can be very therapeutic in a number of ways. Therapists have been depicted in movies in a number of ways. And one of the things that just sort of want to point out is heads around is, you know, the number of ways in which therapists are portrayed and the ways and how far from reality they tend to be, you know? I mean, I think therapists in movies in Hollywood tend to be many people's only experience or exposure to what a therapist possibly could be. And it's a shame because the number of mischaracterizations and you know, personal
stereotypes, lay down on the couch.
Yeah.
It's tell just me like, about your mother.
Yeah. It's just like so many tropes, right? About like therapists and like kind of like how stupid and out of touch they are. And like, you know, like they don't care. And they're just kind of like often used. They're often like foils, you know, like for somebody's, you know, just to point out just how kind of stupid the process is or silly the process is. It seems.
Yeah.
But the reality is that, yeah, it would be silly or stupid if that was what therapy was, but it's not. And so I want to sort of start off with a film like Stutz, because I think this is much closer to what you get when you get a good therapist. It's certainly not something that I want to give the impression that is how every therapist works. It's not. I mean, this guy Stutz, he's definitely like, he's sort of one of a kind in many ways. However, I do think there are a lot of therapists out there that have a very similar approach in terms of the way that they interact with and relate to their patients is, and they wouldn't even maybe call them patients. They would just call them clients or, yeah, you know, people that, you know, they have meetings with. But a number of therapists do operate this way. That's very grounded and down to earth and relatable and humane. That is, I think, the most therapeutic approach to doing therapy. I mean, like you can't, I mean, like, I just feel like it fits for me anyway. So we're going to watch a little bit of this. I also think what's really important about Jonah Hill's movie here, there's a number of things that are courageous and important about it. But I think one of them is that we see somebody like Jonah Hill, who is his, and we've seen this more and more over the years, but this is in depth. Jonah Hill's this, he's a movie star. And he's had a number of fantastic hits. And he's a comedian.
Young.
He's in his late 30s, mid-30s. He struggled with anxiety and panic and depression so much, despite all the success that he's had. In some ways, the success is sort of like, it's contributed to that. And so, you know, many people, we look at these stars, we look at people like Jonah Hill, we think, oh, you know, he's friends with DiCaprio, you know, he's making these fantastic movies, he's getting nominated for Academy Awards. This guy's living the dream, right? And he's actually miserable. You know, and this film gets into where that comes from. And the fact that when you pursue outside success, when you pursue things outside of yourself, it only gets you, it's very limited in what it provides you internally, as far as sense of accomplishment, peace, and contentment.
Well, when you take a look, but I want to make sure when you say style, Doc, the stereotype is that you go into, you open the door, you sit down or lay down on the couch, and you just talk, and somebody's recording something, and they want
you writing it down,
writing it down, but they're not necessarily having you take action, are they? Or give, right?
Yeah. So she great point, Pete, because one of the misnomers about therapy is that what it does is it provides you with this thing called insight, right? And the insight, and that's a really a psychodynamic or analytic approach to things. It's based, rooted in like Freud and Jung and these people. There's a place for it. But obviously, knowing why you do things doesn't necessarily translate into change or making a difference in real life. For some things, it can help. And it's really a part of a bigger process, right? Not the sole, goal of therapy. But many people stop there. They stop at this place, or they do things like they turn it around on the client, and they make the client sort of responsible for digging deeper into their past, into their history, and only until we get to the real root of these things are we going to resolve it. And so that's still based in just insight. There's not a lot of action that gets taken from it. And this approach is different. This approach is very much in line with, I think, modern approaches to therapy that are based in, science, but also common sense. One of the things I like about this approach is his approach is, look, and I'm not downing on it. There's not necessarily, what's new about his approach is the way that he's packaged a number of concepts and a number of things that scientifically over the years we've come to know to be true, right? And he's packaged it in a way that is really accessible to people. And that's a monumental gift, okay? So the basis of what he's saying, necessarily there's a lot of things that are not necessarily new, but that's okay, because what he does is he brings it together in a way that's completely, it's very accessible and useful to people. And that's what they want. We don't want jargon. We don't want lofty concepts. We don't abstract ideas, because there's nothing, we can't get our hands on those. Those aren't, he calls them tools. Those aren't tools, because we can't really, we don't know how to use them.
All right, I can hear everybody yelling, play the damn video.
Yeah. So play the damn video. I'll stop talking.
What's up, Stutz? Hi, Jonah. Okay, entertain me.
I'm just going to start by acknowledging how odd this endeavor is. A patient making a movie about his therapist. But my life has gotten immeasurably better as a result of working with you. If it worked for me, maybe it will work for other people.
Gavin Shrink will say, don't intrude on the patient's process. They will come up with the answers when they're ready. That's not acceptable.
They just listen. And your friends, who are idiots, give you advice. And you want your friends just to listen. And you want your therapist to give you advice.
You don't have to solve all their problems, but you have to give somebody the feeling that they can change right now. What's wrong, Conan?
How can I make a movie where I'm talking about people being vulnerable and working on their problems and not be vulnerable myself?
You can't move forward without being vulnerable. Vulnerability, connection to the rest of the world. You're giving out the signal to the world, I need you because I can't do this by myself.
I was this wildly insecure kid. The work has been accepting and feeling that it's great to be this person. You are still in the struggle and in the fight of being a human just like everybody else.
Take action no matter how frightened you are. If you can teach somebody that, they can change their whole lives.
That makes a lot of sense.
This is such a great moment right now. I still wish you would stop dumping so much shit on me. This is either the greatest documentary ever made or the worst, and it's probably both.
Okay.
Great. So I will expect my royalty check any day from the marketing and the
advertising. Hear those emails? Those are the lawyers.
You watched the whole thing, right?
You gave it to me, and I got 20 pages of notes here. And
dude, you just dug in, didn't you?
Well, I mean, if we're going to do a show, but it was very, like you said, he communicated it in a way that you can consume it. Like, he's got a triangle, and we'll put the triangle up here. Yourself, people, and yourself, people, body, the three levels of life force he talks about.
Talks about the life force, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And
that's, that's basically like Maslow's hierarchy, but it's adapted to convey his concepts, you know, and you know, at the bottom of that is really like, you know, kind of like sleep, exercise, diet, you know, really doing things that like for your body, because that's, you know, what is, I mean, that's where everything starts. But then also connections.
Being a therapist, he says, you have to give people the feeling that you can give them something to use. Right. And he's got these cards and he draws these things. And I'm sure if we go to try to describe every little single thing, I don't know if we spoil the movie or whatever, but it is very actionable. Just watching the movie, that if somebody came in and said, hey, I just saw Stutz and can we work on these same things with you? How would you deal with it?
I'd say, sure. Yeah, we can. Yeah, definitely. We can try that, but just be aware that like, I'm not Stutz, you know, like, and I'm not like, you know, it's not like I'm just learning about his approach and understanding, but I'd be happy to dig in with you and like, you know, see how this works for you and fits in your life. That's definitely something that we can do. And I think that would be great. You know,
he gives you something where you have the feeling of control so you can take action. And he talks about writing. Right. The very action of writing. We've talked about that in the past podcast, which I'm sure everybody, you tell, hey, you know, here's your homework. Write down, you know, when you wake up at night, you know, what were you thinking? You know, not everybody does that.
Well, I mean, almost nobody does it. I mean, frankly, right. People are just like, yeah, OK, yeah, I'll do that. And then when it comes to it, you know, it's a very human kind of dilemma. But he tries to get at that a little bit with drawing pictures. He likes to draw pictures and symbols and stuff like that that convey concepts, which is also, you know, that's great too, because people tend to be very visual. I mean, we can get a lot of information through a picture, much more than if we read something, you know. But we can convey things when we draw and write. The thing is, we convey things that are unconscious and they become more conscious, right? So I don't know if you've ever done any drawing or art, but I've done some art in the past, but I mainly like to draw. The things that come out in my drawings, like, I don't know where they come from, you know, but it's always it's really surprising, like how the things in the picture are connected to each other and connected to something that's going on inside of me.
And then he talks about the string of pearls, and he's just drawing a circle and a line, a circle. And then he just puts a little dot in one of those. Remember what that was?
Turd. Turd.
Turd.
Each one has a turd.
What does that mean?
I think it just means that life is messy, man. Like, you know, you're going to do some stuff and there might be some great, like it's the way that he talks about pain and he talks about struggle, you know, that these are things where that's like the turd, right? That's all the bullshit. That's the shit that you have to like deal with. But what that actually it also introduces the pearl, which is all the benefits or the lessons that struggle and that pain conveys to you. And his primary idea is that pain is like, you know, you can't avoid pain and it's not that you shouldn't want to, it's just that he reverses it. He says you need to, like, we want to welcome pain, because pain is actually what illuminates the secrets, you know, to like what's out there for us. Right. Pain keeps us back, but if we go through it, it actually disappears. And then once we get through it, we actually can do things that we never really thought we were able to do. And that's, you know, that's obviously what people are looking to do when they come into therapy.
And the concept of the shadow, can you explain that to me?
The concept of the shadow? Yeah. Well, the shadow is basically,
Listen to your shadow.
Listen to your shadow. Well, so, and he talks about acts, right? I forget what he calls it. It's like it person acts or something like that.
Yeah.
And it's different from the shadow. And person acts is like, or the X factor or whatever he's calling it. I forget, but is really that part of that thing inside of you that tries to mess everything up. Right. It's like actively wanting to like mess shit up for you. The shadow is different. The shadow is it's sort of like this repository for all those things that you consider to be unacceptable about yourself. Right. So whatever hidden desires or thoughts or, you know, feelings you have that you consider to be unacceptable, those get pushed back and out of conscious awareness. And that where it goes is what Carl Jung called the shadow. It sort of becomes this place. You know, it's still there, but it's a shadow. And it's like, you know, the description is apt because they're like these dark secrets and desires and stuff like that. Reality is that we all have them, and that they, in order to be whole as a person or fully integrated, there's a level of acceptance about, look, this is, you know, these are mine. They are what they are. And they're part of me, and I can, you know, use them in different ways. I can act on them or not on act on them, but they don't make me a bad person, and they're not something that I necessarily have to fight with. I can actually welcome into my personality, but I get to decide whether how I behave or respond.
You know, it's hard to, we don't want to spoil the show for people, but we want to entice people to watch it. It's worth the 90 minutes. It
is worth the 90 minutes.
Especially, yeah. I think Jonah Hill, he ran into problems. He was 13, 14, overweight, anxiety. You know, his mother comes into the picture, and it was really kind of cool how they were, nobody was trying to be defensive, but they were being defensive. You know what I mean? It's very, very uncomfortable thing.
It's very typical. Yeah, absolutely. We can't help but, like, you know, we want to protect ourselves. And so we have ways of doing that that are, some of them are more obvious.
Well, you know, one of the tools that he uses, and this isn't part of what Stutz was doing, but Jonah Hill said that, and a lot of people do this, maybe even I do, is they use humor, right? To not deal with anything real. Is that true?
Yeah, humor is a great deflection. I mean, humor has been, I think Freud called it like the highest coping, you know, like the best coping strategy or the most sophisticated coping strategy. And it can be. I mean, like if you look at like Viktor Frankl, who was a concentration camp survivor, I mean, like humor was an essential part of his ability to cope with the horrors that were going on around him. There's gallows humor we talk about with, you know, that's something that's very common in first responders or you know, people in professions like mine. You develop gallows humor. It's a kind of a dark humor. It's just a way to cope with the shit that you're seeing. And it's the old, I got to laugh so I don't cry. And I can still do my job.
Right.
Function. You know, thing, you know, it's like, if I didn't laugh or I didn't do something with this, it would cripple me or destroy me. And so what you end up doing is you use humor, and that actually can become, though, something that hobbles you later in life if you're not able to address or deal with like true concerns or legitimate issues, so that it becomes like, it's like it takes over in a way, so that what helped you previously and now is now hindering you. An example that was given to me by a supervisor once was, imagine you're on a life raft and you take this life raft to shore. And you're on like this island, and in front of you is like the woods or the jungle, and you've got to go through the jungle in order to get to safety or whatever. So what you do is you take your life boat and you put it on your back and you carry it through the jungle, thinking that you're going to need it, right? And you're never going to make it through the jungle if you try to do that, right? But that's what we do. We hold on to these coping strategies that are no longer adaptive, right? or use them in situations where they're no longer adaptive. It's funny, like Jonah Hill and I, it's interesting. I mean, the things that he said in there about his history, I can totally identify with. I mean, I was overweight as a kid, ruthlessly teased and all that stuff. It's funny though, and I look at old pictures and I have an immediate visceral reaction to them. It's interesting when I saw his picture that he showed, that is one of those pictures that like he looks at it, he's just like, he can't stand how he looks. I looked at it, I love the guy. I'm like, this guy's awesome.
That was a shadow.
He's like this kid with like, he's got like curly hair that's dyed. He's got like these rose tinted glass. I'm like, this guy's a player, man. I love him.
I think he's super bad like, with that.
At that, even at that age, he was just like, I'm doing my thing, you know, which is like very cool. Very cool.
And then it gets a little dark there a little bit as his brother passed away. And then he came and talked to the Stutz and he took a snapshot. What was the deal with the snapshot?
So like it was after Jonah had come in basically Jonah looks at the snapshot of himself after a therapy session where he's been talking about his brother. And he says, you know, I look gaunt. I look tired. I look just sort of drained. And his therapist says, you do, but it's also, you also, this is also the picture of victory. You know, you went through hell and you're here. You survived it. And that's victory. You know, the strength that it took for you to go through that hell. You may look tired and whatever, but that's what victory looks like. You know, victory isn't like necessarily this happy, joyful experience. It could be an experience of just surviving and getting through. That's something that Jung talked a lot about. He talked a lot about, you know, you need conflict and you need, we need to have conflict. We need to have setbacks. We need to have
three aspects of reality: pain, uncertainty, and constant work.
Yeah.
People don't like that third one.
Constant work?
Yeah.
Well, the reality is that as human beings, like we wouldn't know what to do with ourselves. We would create work if we didn't have work.
Right.
We would. We just make our lives difficult if they weren't difficult. Because that's what, because as human beings, we're like, first of all, we're doers. We like to do stuff with our time. But we're also like, we're also trying to always figure shit out, you know? And the way that we do that is we like to stir stuff up, you know? We like to create trouble. So constant work, you know, you could view that as something, you could think of it as being an Amazon delivery truck driver, you know, something that's grueling and you're on a treadmill and it's unsatisfying. Mm-hmm. Or you could view it as it's work that constantly bears fruit and it constantly reinvigorates me. So that I have energy, I have vitality to my life. You know, I think that's the constant work though, that like he's like we're talking about going to. So it's a choice basically in the kind of work that you're going to be doing. Can't avoid the work, but it's the kind of work that you're choosing.
And the mom's in there and they're going through their deal. I don't want to get into that. You know, you can watch it. It is interesting how they're all trying to it's almost like they're trying to help one another. It's
something that was kind of beautiful about that moment. So and I, maybe you're avoiding this, but Stutz makes this joke at one point about banging Judah's mom. Just like friends would do, like on a playground or lunch or something. It's like, yeah, well, not forget. Let's not forget about that time I banged your mom. Yeah, I mean, it was like an offhanded comment, a joke, irreverent type of thing I might do, by the way. But
did you have
relationship? But he knows Jonah. He knows Jonah, and he knows like that relationship that is okay in that relationship because they have an understanding, right? And so Jonah saw like Stutz like take a step back for a second, and you know. And he's like, I'm going to tell my mom when she comes tomorrow. I'm going to tell her you said that. He's like, you're not going to tell her that, are you? And he's like, so what he did was he, I don't know what he was thinking. I think he was just sort of like, I think he was testing or something.
Yeah.
And Stutz was just like, okay. So he tells his mom that. He says that Stutz said he had sexual relations with
you. He wants to have relations with
you. No, then he had. Yeah. Did you have sexual relationships with him? And she says, oh, believe me, he'd remember it. If he did. And Jonah was just like, oh. But what was beautiful about that is Jonah got taught a lesson there. You know, he's like, all right, man. Stutz was like, you can tell her if you want to. But Stutz was just like, you might not like the results. And he didn't. He was just like, oh, fuck, why did I say that? Like, now I got to picture my mom with my therapist, you know? So it was a perfect sort of like moment where it's like, I don't know. You do something you know you shouldn't do. And Stutz, he kind of knew he shouldn't do it. And he got taught a lesson.
Yeah.
And he got taught a lesson in a, you know, the world taught him a lesson. His mom reacted that way and he just regretted it.
And I may gloss over this point and you can add more to it, but because the thing I want to get to is talking about the maze and part X wants fairness. And I think that's where a lot of people get caught up in, hey man, that's not fair. How did that grab you?
I think it's right on point. I think we get very wrapped up in this idea of fairness, which is basically a human conception. I mean, the world isn't fair. Nature doesn't give a shit about fairness. It just does what it does. You know, it doesn't care. It's not, I mean, that's a human idea, but we get locked up in it. Like, it's like, no, that must be. And if it's not fair, then it's not, then, you know, I can't accept it. I can't accept it. And I can't behave. I can't act despite the fact that it was unfair. I have to like get justice, right? And getting justice can be like up here, like bashing the person or revenge fantasies and stuff like that. But it leads nowhere. And basically it leads to a life that is meaningless or unsatisfying, very unsatisfying at the most.
Goal is you want forward motion. The straightest point between two points is a line, and you're going in this maze and recurring thoughts that get you nowhere. I thought that was pretty spot on.
Yeah, it's a little bit like arguing with the conductor over your seat on a train, and the train is leaving, and you're sitting there arguing with him because you think it's unfair, but you don't get on the train at all because you're so stuck on this idea of fairness. Instead, what he's saying is just get on the fucking train, you know, just get on the train and go where you need to go. Right. Cause like, that's just a small part of the overall picture, and that people are going to, I mean, like unfairness is like if you're alive, unfair things happen to you multiple times a day, you know, and it's about just, you know, it's about moving anyway. That's where the strength and courage comes in.
Just, I hate to bring this up, but like politics and the outliers, which either side you're on, the echo chambers, it just seems like to say, they should, hey, watch this movie.
In terms of like wanting fairness and justice and stuff?
Yeah, it's left or right. It's whatever the conspiracy theory is, okay? Right. People get caught up in that stuff because they want it to be true. But the situation, you have to go this way and you just caught over and over and in the same group of people.
Toxic, right?
Yeah. And it gets you nowhere. And it gets you nowhere. It gets you away from love. How about that? Was pretty heavy when Stutz was talking about love. Close your eyes and imagine everybody, everything in the world. I don't want to get I don't want to describe it too much.
Well, but basically his idea was that like there's love, like the universe has love in it. Like there's love in the universe, whether you want it or not. It wants to be in your life. It wants to, I mean, like love is like wants to freely give itself to you. And all you need to do is be willing to be open enough to accept it and vulnerable enough to accept it. The idea being that like loving your, it's sort of like, it's a very, kind of in some ways, it's a very biblical thing, like, you know, loving your enemy, right? Now that's, of course, he's not saying that like you get walked over and you allow these people to treat you like crap, you know. He's saying that in your heart, you don't have to hate these people. You don't have an obligation to not like these people. These are people like you that are trying to make their way through the world. You can experience love and compassion for the fact that they are part of the human struggle as well, right?
He says, do you want to be right or do you want to create something?
Yep.
Oh.
I love that. And so many people, you know, I deal with this a lot. It really struck a chord for me, you know, in terms of like, even like the endeavor, like this podcast or my book that I'm writing or TikTok, there are many, I'm constantly having to work against this narrative that nobody, like your ideas are not good enough or they're not interesting enough or like, or you don't know what you're doing or people are going to come in and point out how wrong you are and you're going to be embarrassed and look stupid. And like, these are thoughts and feelings that I constantly grapple with and have to like, sort of like work with and tame so that I can create, so that I can continue to do what it is that I want to do to get to the place where he talks about, and I think this is true, it's not so much what your plans are for life, it's life's plans for you. Like life has plans for you, right? So like you can decide to have your own plans, but just be aware that if you're going to force, you know, the idea of being right and you know, have other people recognize that you're right, that life is going to keep moving on without you. And that's going to be where you're going to be stuck. You're going to stay there and you're not going to be able to, you won't be exposed to the power of creation, being able to create, right?
Because Jonah, his brother passed away. I don't remember when that was, but that was when he was in a pretty big funk. And I believe he talks about the
suddenly
cloud, and you know, he was talking about an airplane. You go into the clouds and then you go up into the sun, no matter how bad, you know, the storm is. And he talks about the grateful flow. No, imagine the worst thing that is ever going to happen to you, but you will still exist. Is that how it went?
Yeah, I mean, so like Jonah, I think it was a pulmonary embolism that like got his brother. And his brother was, it was very sudden. It was very unexpected. It was like one of these things. It was like a lightning strike, basically.
Yeah.
And that just devastated him, you know. So I can relate to this because I lost my brother, you know, my brother.
Right.
From suicide. And you know, one of the things I'm always like, you know, they're just, you know, you got to challenge these ideas. You got to ask the hard questions. So I was sort of like, yeah, well, this sounds really good. You know, like, but what if somebody loses their kid? Like, what if their kid dies? Because I have kids. Like,
yeah.
And I've always said, like, if one of my kids dies, I don't know if I can survive that, you know? And that was I actually got his book too. But he reminded, I was reminded in the book, because they write about this, Viktor Frankl, like, if you want somebody who has authority on this issue to tell you or to demonstrate to you that this actually, you can move on from this and you can still live a life that is, has creativity, has contentment, look to Viktor Frankl. He's a concentration camp survivor. He was in four different concentration camps. He was enslaved. and he survived those, got through it. And he got through it, like, you know, with his sanity. While his mother was murdered, his father was murdered, his brother was murdered, and one of his best friends, I think his best friend, was murdered. I mean, you want to talk about loss. So he was able to, but the way that he got past this was using some of the principles here that Stutz is talking about. And that was helpful because, like, you do need somebody of authority to, like, you need to have example. Like, I want to see, like, real examples of people who, like, use this and dealt with, like, real tragedy. You know, not that losing your brother isn't a real tragedy, but, you know, for me, the ultimate tragedy is losing a child. So yeah,
that was, I believe, loss processing, non-attachment, and he gets into something where be willing to lose everything that you're eventually going to go into the sun and burn up. Like, wow, that's pretty. That's very motivating. Thank you, Stutz.
Yeah, I mean, we're all going to die.
The minute you're born, you started dying. So
we're all going to die. You're going to die. Nobody gets out alive.
But it's we're talking about this because we want you to watch it, and you have to see the whole thing. We're not doing any justice to this at all, except these concepts that maybe people watch it, they hear what we talk about, or they watch us on YouTube and they, you know, say, hey man, comment here, comment there.
Yeah, I'd be interested if people try the techniques, or if they read the book, or any feedback that people have on this, I think would be, you know, great to hear.
And it was, you know, they're trying to give a gift, you know, the gift of the experience through the therapy that they got. They want to, you know, pay it forward, share the experience, have other people do it. And I think that's good for other therapists to watch that, you know, to hone their craft. And I don't know if it's just dealing with kids, teens, or I think it's, you know, all ages. So it seems like a lot of the problems that everybody has, you know, kind of falls into these areas here. So Netflix.
Yeah. And well, let me tell you, I mean, here's something that's, like, super important about this approach, and one that he talks about, which is, and I don't know how much airtime it's given in general for therapists, but therapists can be afraid of their clients, and they can be afraid of, I mean, it can be very daunting when a client comes in and they tell you, I mean, like, imagine a client that comes in and says, you know, I lost my child and I can't get over it. And I don't know what to do. I mean, that's fucking intimidating, man. So, you know, you got therapists who will run from situations like that, or they'll do things to sabotage that relationship because they can't handle it. Because they just feel too much. It's either it can strike a personal issue for them, or it just feels too overwhelming and too much. And what Stutz does here, I think, is very important. He basically says, no. This is not about you fixing their problems. This is about you guys together embarking on a process to find the things that work for them. Or find where the fear is and to get past it and to cope with it. It's not, so the answer is, like, you don't have to on high sort of hand them down as the authority figure. No, you're with them on the ground. You're both on the same team working together. To me, that's a much more sustainable approach.
And they both lost brothers.
Mm-hmm.
And Stutz has Parkinson's. Spoiler!
And he's got Parkinson's, yeah. Yeah.
I mean, that's, I don't know how I'm going to do this, but it's like, spoiler, watch this first. And then, you know, I think that would be interesting to chat afterwards. Use all your burner profiles out there, social media, ask your question. But no, Doc, that was a good find, man. That was a good find. And what's kind of funny is when you pass any of these things on, they take it, it's almost like, in the MD world, when a chiropractor comes around, oh, you can't do that. That's not how I was taught.
Yeah. Well, maybe, you know, that's the thing, though. right? That's exactly the those are, I mean, to use his word, forces that we're all up against, which is you can't,
right?
Not allowed, wrong. You're going to do something terrible, something you're going to regret this terribly if you do it. I mean, maybe, but like when shit's not working, why do you keep doing it? Why would you do the same thing that's not working? Right?
Because so it's like a great subscription model. I keep making money.
Yeah, right. And feeling unfulfilled. And not being able to sleep because I'm anxious and feeling like a fraud. Trying to pretend like I'm confident when I'm not, right? I mean, who wants to do that?
Not anybody me. On YouTube?
I'd rather be uncredentialed than have to do that. I mean, seriously, it's not a profession I'd want to stay in.
Yeah.
If that's what I had to do, you know, because it makes no sense, especially if it's not helping.
Yeah, it's always have an open mind. Nobody is right. What's best for the client? Keep putting Band-Aids on things, or, you know, trying to correct. And that's kind of what Stutz was doing. Hey, man, try these things. I think they'll help. I think there could be a possible end game, and let me check up on you going forward.
Yeah. I mean, it's not like he doesn't build in a feedback mechanism. I mean, it's like constant.
Yeah.
There's constant feedback happening. He's not saying go do this and then, you know.
Bye.
Not being he's being accountable. He's accountable for everything that he's saying.
I wonder if Stutz is still around.
It's a good question.
I might reach out to him and have him reject me.
That'd be great. That'd be awesome. I'm sure he's not getting any requests at this point.
He's got bigger things, man. But
see, there's that talk.
Well, he does have Parkinson's, man. That's a he had to take a nap in the thing. I get it. When he says that scene, when he first realized that he got it, he went to bed on a Friday and woke up on a Monday.
Yeah. Could you imagine?
Oh, God. Doc, you have a good Thanksgiving, man.
Love you, brother. You too. Enjoy your turkey.
I heart you very much. I appreciate you. I'm very thankful for you.
Thank you, Pete. I appreciate you too, in all truth. Yeah.
All honesty. And we appreciate our listeners and viewers out there.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. We want to hear what you have to say, too. Even if you disagree, please. Yeah. I want to know what you think.
Blame Pete.
Blame Pete.
Bye guys.
Amen.